so glad to have you back here at this place. Today is an exciting day. Amen to that.
Amen. Amen.
We have a guest speaker. Dr. Kim lives in here, and his wife, Linda, with us. And glad to have you here at this place. It was such a great honor and blessings and privilege to have you here as a guest speaker. We're very, very excited about your message and all the things God has done through your life as well. How's everybody doing?
Good.
So you're done. All right, very good. Thank you. We have a family who would like to join the church today. Whose family? Would you please come? Two beautiful kiddos. All right. Let me ask you a question. As a member of the First United Methodist Church, will you faithfully participate in its ministry by your prayers, presence, gift, and service? You are witness as well. Thank you. Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith and confirm their hope and perfect them in love. So we are collecting all the pennies for helping our mission, especially our the Spirit to receive God's word for you.
Help us, O Lord, to be attentive to your word and will.
Hallelujah.
Thanks
be to God. Amen. Keep singing. If you are able, we're going to sing a song, Christ for the World We Sing.
Son joining, trying to join the Air Force Academy. That's quite a process. He's partway through, but still some more to go. So please pray that that goes well, that he will be successful in that. And her brother-in-law was deployed yesterday. So pray for him. Other joys or concerns?
Come on up here.
Okay. needed. He's faced a lot of challenges, and, but he's tough. And God is with him, so please pray for Mike. You had a joy about a week ago.
Yes, we had a wedding.
Yeah, had a wedding.
I had a new grandson.
A granddaughter was married last Saturday, I believe it was. A week ago, Saturday. Any other joys or concerns? Yes. For the school leaders, school staff, everybody. You know, this virus situation isn't getting better right now. It's getting worse. And so that's going to be an issue for the schools and personnel to have to make some decisions about. And so please pray for all of us, because those are tough decisions. Other? Yes, Fish. Okay. The lost wedding ring, Jason misplaced, temporarily misplaced, has been found. That is definitely a joy.
He's never taking it off ever again.
Yeah. Any other joys or concerns? Pray for our nation. You know, the election is passed, but the division and some of the anxiety and the ill feelings have not passed yet. So we need to pray that our country will heal and that we'll move forward in a positive way, in unity, and be the strong nation that we've always been. Other joys or concerns? Nebraska won a football game. Wow. That's what you call a miracle, I think. We've been trying to get it back in the Big 12, soften our schedule a little bit. Any other joy or concerns? Okay. I think that's it.
Dear loving God, thank you once again for calling each one of us to be here. We are truly blessed that you have called us, loved us, and showed us your face. Now we are here in a community of faith and hope and love, where we can truly worship you in spirit and in truth, and where we can share the love of Christ. Gracious God, open us to the reality of your embracing love in this place. Lead us to a deeper place where we can experience your love and healing and forgiveness. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us as we continue to worship you, and help us experience your grace and your healing hand and touch as we come to you. Now we intentionally pray for those who are weak and sick and broken in our family, church, community, and all over the world. May your Holy Spirit be with them and heal them physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. Today, we have offered many names in our prayers: healing, restoration, and hope and peace. Some of these names have been spoken aloud in this gathering, while others remain in our hearts and in our minds. extend to all people. Your grace will extend to all people. Strengthen each one of us in this chaotic time and help us to hold onto your hope, joy, and love, and faith as well. Lord, as we continue to worship you, prepare our hearts and minds to listen to you. Lord, speak to us as we listen to you, and touch our hearts as we worship you. Pour out your grace and love as we respond to you today. Today we are eternally blessed. We are truly thankful for everything you have done and given for each one of us. Let us pray the prayer our Lord Jesus Christ taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to sing a song. Lord, listen to your children.
Good morning. It's such a great honor and privilege and blessings to introduce our guest speaker, Dr. Chanute. 11 years ago, I came to
$500 in my pocket. Can you believe it? $500 in my pocket. One way trip and my passport with F1 student visa. I was hungry and thirsty in my seminary life, and by the grace of God, I encountered wonderful man of faith in my life. 11 years ago, God, it was a blessing for me to meet Dr. Ken Luton. Since then, we've been a very close friend. I call him my American dad. He used to be an Encore director. He traveled more than 100 countries, and he made a huge difference. He used to be a big guy, still a big guy in my life. And he used to, as soon as he finished his ministry in New York, he went back to a Missouri conference, and he became a DS, and he mentored a lot of people into the ministry. And then before I got here, I used to work at Grace United Methodist Church in Olathe. Ken, he was a big guy. He did all kind of finance and all the ministry. He was a director of all the ministry, and he was a big guy. So I had a great time. It's such a great honor to introduce Dr. Luton to you, and would you please welcome him with a big hand.
Says, you know, the sun never sets on the British Empire, don't you? And I said, yes, Bishop, I know that saying. He said, do you know why? And I said, well, because the empire's all the way around the world. And he said, no, because God doesn't trust the British. So, as I learned about the empire of Britain and how it was developed, I marveled that the missionaries went to them. So when they went to India, they took missionaries, and there was a very strong Methodist church there that still today is an active Methodist church in India. Over 5,000 schools were started and hospitals built there. The empire went to Southern Africa, one of my favorite places, and there the Methodist church was established. We know it was also brought to the colonies here in North America, in the empire established. It went to distant places. And in the years I was with MPUMCOR, I actually visited 50 nations where there was a Methodist church, and some very strange places that you wouldn't have expected a church. One of those was Fiji, the island of Fiji. And we were there, Linda and I, and our guide said, "Now, you know, Fiji is officially a Methodist nation." And of course, my ears perked up. And so we inquired, "What do you mean it's a Methodist nation?" And he said, "Well, when Cook, the discoverer, the British captain, came in his ships to Fiji, we were a Polynesian people, and we believed in many different gods. But he brought missionaries, and he left them. And a couple years later, he returned back, and he asked where the missionaries were. They weren't there to greet him. They said, oh, they passed. They died. And he said, oh, that's terrible. He said, well, I have some missionaries on this ship. I'll leave them here for you. And the people were a little puzzled, but they said, okay. A couple years later, he was back, and he said, where are the missionaries? And they said, well, you know, the Polynesian people, you would call it, were cannibalistic. And he said, don't tell me you ate my missionaries. And they said, the king said, yes, I did. He said, that's a terrible thing what you've done. And he said, well, I want to repent of that. I felt very bad. And I want to follow your God. And so the king did. He repented. Captain Cook asked him, what kind of Christian do you want to be? And he said, well, what kind of Christians were the missionaries? And they said, Methodist. He said, well, be Methodist. And every village in Fiji, there's a Methodist church. And that faith is carried on as they went out from Fiji. Now, it's a very strange way to do evangelism, I believe. I wouldn't encourage you to do that now around the small communities here. But it just goes to share how the story of our church grew and went in so many different places. I chaired the Global Ministries for our conference for a number of years, and one of the things I wanted to do was to rediscover the mission. The mission's got so far from us as a people, a local church, that we really don't understand what's going on. So I started taking teams in the 80s of people out into the world. We went into India, Nepal. We went into Africa, a number of countries, Southern Africa. We went into Central America with teams. We ended up the team going into Russia when it was still the Soviet Union. And we looked at those early years of the missionaries that came and what they did. The second thing that I want to make a point of is, the first is the world literally is our parish. We are a global church. And this is a great example of a global church. Mike was a part of the Methodist Church in Korea. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a few moments. But his coming here is not that unusual today. There are Korean pastors, some thousand of them in the United States today, serving Methodist Church. There are African pastors. I was in Western Kansas at the annual conference, and one of the pastors came up. He said, "You remember me?" And I said, "Yes, Cecil. What are you doing here?" Cecil was the program director in Zimbabwe. And he said, "Well, I've immigrated here. And Western Kansas reminds me of home. And I love serving churches out here." So not only are we a melting pot of nations where people have come in, but in our church, we exhibit that. We are a global church. We're We're very strong here in the States. We're extremely strong in the country of Africa, where the church is, continent of Africa, where the church is growing. And so, as a people, we have a mission. And that mission comes in the way that we live out our faith. John Wesley was a teacher. He was an Anglican pastor who had a passion for his ministry. And he had a mandate that he lived by, and that was the Matthew 25 passage that was read today. Wesley saw it as his duty to be Christ-like in the way he lived, and he went amongst the poor, the hungry, the naked. And he made that the church's mandate to go out in that way. I've served in the appointment of bishops for 50 years. Linda and I went where we were sent. And in the late 80s, because of the work I was doing with the mission programs of our church, I was nominated to be the director of the United Methodist Committee on Relief. Only it was a very small committee that raised funds and funded other people to do his mission. And what the Council of Bishops said is, Cam, we want a director to come in, and we want our church to be engaged by the ministry of our poor. We want you to develop a volunteer program where people can go, and collection programs. You know, the Baptists are not the only people that collect things. We Methodists can collect things. And, you know, we want you to put all of that together, so that we as a church go out into the world and people come to know Wesley's passion for the poor. Well, when you come from Kansas City and you pastor a local church, that seems like an awful big task to be given. And it was, but along with that task, I was given a wonderful staff in New York and brought a couple of folks into that staff, and we began to look at that. We said one of the things that we could do is to provide a response to disasters in this country. And there were a number of them at that time. And so we could create an UNCOR volunteer program that could go in and work disasters. Another thing that we could do is we could connect with our global partners, our churches in Africa, India, the Philippines, and those kind of places. And we could see what their needs were and how we could reclaim what we used to do. When we went out as missionaries, we went into the community and we built a school, and we built a clinic, and we built a church. We serve the whole person. We can do these kind of things. So that's what we began to do. We organized a disaster response team. We began to do some training. We began to put together a network of how we would collect things. The first collection that we have, and some of you might remember this, was in 1991. We were asked by UNCOR to collect food items to send to Russia because the Soviet Union had collapsed. And there was a great food shortage in Moscow in the winters of 91 and 92. Just basic foods for the widow societies and the orphanages and things that we had there. And the Department of Defense visited with us and said, is there any way that you can respond to that? We'll give you the transportation, we'll give you whatever we need. But can you find people that will go and help us? There was a fear that terrorists would overrun the Russian government and get the weapons and things and terrorize the world. And we were trying to bring stability to Russia. It seems crazy to talk about things like that in this day and age when we've polarized ourselves so much. But there was a time when a door was open, and many of us passed through and made very, very close friends with the Russian people and had this image of a world coming together. And so we took food in there. And I'll never forget in 92, the winter of 92, which was really brutal in Moscow, of walking into a building where we had a soup kitchen running. And this was for the widow society, the women who had lost their husband or their sons in the Afghan war. And the women heard that the director of UNCOR was there, the person that was providing the soup, and how they would come up with tears in their eyes and we would embrace. And through the translators, they would share their appreciation that in their hour of need, we were there for them. Well, that kind of experience, you know, encourages you. So as I was coming back from one of those experiences, I was in Zurich, Switzerland, and I got a phone call from the general secretary, my boss, and he said, you need to get to Miami and get that thing you've been working on going. And I said, well, no, it's just on paper right now. He said, you need to get there, and you need to be there as quick as you can. So I flew to Miami to encounter Hurricane Andrew. That was our first experience at working in disaster response as a Methodist church. 13 of our churches were blown away out in South Dade County. When we went in with some of the first teams, everything was leveled. And the only thing that the Bush government knew to do at that time was to park an aircraft carrier off the coast, and they were flying in. It reminded one of Vietnam. Literally, the destruction was so massive. And I came out of that and through our network put an appeal out like we had for the food program for volunteers to come and for a list of items that help us help the people there in South Dade County. The response was absolutely unbelievable. We ended up renting a large warehouse in Miami because there were so many goods being sent there. And the volunteers came, and we hadn't thought about where they would stay and that kind of thing. So we found an old shopping center that had some walls up on it, a few roofs, and we put the volunteer teams, we bought that piece of property, put the volunteer teams in there to make it like a hotel-type place that we could go and serve. One of the most massive responses that we have done as a church, within a few months, we were making a significant difference. And I got a call from President Bush's office and said, we would like for you to come to Washington, D.C. The president wants to honor the Methodists for the work they've done in Hurricane Andrew. And I went. And the program was about the Mennonites, the Methodists, the Salvation Army. From that, we got an invitation to set a FEMA's team, and we became, in the next few years, with other disasters, one of being the Midwest floods, one of the premier volunteer agencies where people were going by the thousands into different places. I got a call from the Clinton administration then that said, we have lost our provider in Bosnia. We've come to learn in the last few years that the U.S. government does nothing, it contracts everything. And we were providing aid in the war in Bosnia to the Bosnians and the Croatians and the Serbians that were serving there, to the general populations. But the group that was doing that was caught smuggling some arms. So I went to D.C. and they said, Dr. Lucci, we understand you're a head of a relief agency. And I said, I am. They said, have you ever worked in what, refugee camps? Well, actually, I had visited a refugee camp, and I said, yeah, I have a little knowledge of refugee camps. And they said, good, we would like you to go to Zenitz, Bosnia, and we would like you to run the 17 refugee camps there. So I went with one of my colleagues, and we looked at it, and we said, if we can do it in the U.S. because of our European church, and we had several churches in that area, let's see if we can do it here. We brought a program in Bosnia where we not only did the refugee camps, but we began to work with the youth and the children there whose schools were closed. You know, we're in the pandemic, but a war does the same thing. It closed the schools. The kids had no opportunities. And we rented a couple of buildings, and we began to hold classes for the children in the city. And a thing called the internet was coming on, and we were able to get on that, and the kids were able to talk to their friends and family that escaped that area and gone across Europe and other places, and began to make a difference there. It's a program that the Women's Division, the United Methodist Women, would pick up and would do in many other places. It is a program that when the wars broke out, children soldiers? I was there and I thought, what is a children's soldier? And I actually got caught behind the lines in the war and was in one of those camps and saw these 8 and 10 and 12 year old children carrying the weapons of the warlords and fighting the war. That was in 96. I was invited back in 2006 to celebrate the peace. When I went back, I went out to some of our schools, and sitting in the schools in the first grade classroom were young adults, 18-year-olds and 19-year-olds, that had had no schooling during that period. Grace Church would work with the Kansas Board of Education, and we would take their A-plus program, literally to Liberia, out into areas where there wasn't an internet. We were able to make it work. And we set up classrooms. And we set up opportunities to retrain these young people so that they can become productive citizens. The last piece I want to close with around this is what I came to understand about our church. And it is a mind-boggling understanding for me, is that not only did the Methodist missionaries go out across the world, but they established churches, Methodist churches. And we were taught as we moved across this world to follow Wesley's instructions on how we were to minister to the world. Wesley took our gospel, he took a passage like what was read today that we all wish we could do, but it's not as easy as it sounds to feed the hungry or clothe the naked or visit the prisons. And Wesley said, this is what Jesus meant. This is how we're to live. The first thing as Christians we're to do is to do no harm to others. Love your neighbor can simply be put in this way. Do no harm. When you get up in the morning, pray, Lord, that my actions will not cause any harm to another. And the second thing we're called to do is to do good. To do good. And then he wrote it in this way. Do all the good you can, by all the means you can, and all the ways you can, and all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. Make love the center of your life, and to do good. What I have come to discover in the world that I travel through and the over 100 countries that I've been in, is in some places, Wesley's teaching of taking hold in an unbelievable kind of way. And one of those is in Korea. Korea is fairly new to Methodism. I think it's been about 100 years in Korea. And Korea went through a lot. And the division of Korea. And the destruction and the death. But the church grew during that time. The Koreans are an amazing people. They have grown the church so large that there really is, I won't say not opportunities, because as you've experienced with Michael, Korean pastors know how to get people involved in the life of the church and want to be a part of it. And they're very good at that. But if you're going to be ordained a pastor of the Korean church, an elder, you either have to start a new church or you have to be a missionary. So when I went to Russia in 1991, I was in Moscow, and a couple of people came to me, and they said, we understand you're Methodist. I said, yes. They said, we have a Methodist church here. It's at the university. Could you come tomorrow? And I said, sure, and I went. Now, it's a very small world. The pastor of that Methodist church at the university was Christine Hemmer. Christine was a Liberian who came to Chandler, and her roommate was our orthodontist, Laura. I knew her. And I said, what are you doing here? And she said, well, when the Soviet Union collapsed, there were a lot of African students here, and they're in communist countries, and they fear for their lives to go back. So they've basically come to live here. And she said, I have started a fellowship church group with that. She said, you need to know, also there are six more churches like this. And she introduced me to a young man who was Asian, and I know my Asian people, and I realized he was Korean. And he said, I'd like for you to come next Sunday to my church. North Koreans, in large numbers, were working in Moscow. And of course, when the Soviet Union collapsed, they didn't want to go back to North Korea. They saw this as an opportunity to be free. And so these North Korean people were Methodists. And they needed a pastor. And I went back to New York, and we had a Korean pastor in New York City that was serving. I explained the situation. He said, I'll get pastors. And they went, and they started. Now, if you know any of the history of Russia, when the government kicked all the churches out, only five religious communities can operate in the Soviet Union, and the Methodists are one of them. And we're across 40 different cities in Russia with Methodist churches and Methodist pastors. We have an annual conference. We even have a bishop there. Later on, I was down in Cambodia. The Khmer Rouge had collapsed. And there, the people with killing fields, they had killed one-third of the population. If you wore glasses, you were killed because they figured you were educated. One-third of the population. But finally, that terrible regime had come to a close. And the aid agencies, and we were one. I'd come in with the Chinese out of Singapore to work with the population there in Phnom Penh. And we discovered that there was a Methodist church already operating there. And we went to the Methodist church, and guess who was leading the Methodist church, Michael? It was a Korean pastor. He had already started the work, and he helped us understand what was going on there. We came to understand that there were seven other expat communities around the world, Paris, Switzerland, and California, that had started churches. And the people's philosophy was simply a philosophy to help the poor. I've not been in a poor nation in Cambodia at that time. But that was their philosophy, to help the poor. And they were so poor, they had no money. But the offering every Sunday was a huge bag that sat at the door of the church, and people would bring in a small bag of rice and add it. And then that rice would be distributed to the people. My last example was, I was in Zimbabwe in the late 80s when they talked about the need for a university. And I, with our church and many others, saw that need. And we became involved in that. I've been on the board of directors of Africa University since its initiation. It's a phenomenal institution. It has students from usually 28 to 30 African countries coming there. There are all kinds of degree programs, but one that was put in place is a program called an Institute for Peace and Democracy. It was a USAID grant that we got. And it has started a degree in that. We built a campus there, a beautiful campus. And at the center of that campus is one of the most unusual chapels that I've ever experienced. It's built like an African building with a thatched kind of roof and stuff like that. But it's huge. It was given by the Korean Methodist in Korea. Because at the center of the university should be a place where people could develop spiritually. They could come to learn how to do good in the world we live. I share these kind of things because it's no accident that Michael Park has come here. And when he came into my church that first time, we invited him to a Labor Day lunch that we were having. And he has been to me and our family like a son. And then we had the good fortune for Esther to come, and I got to participate up in Montana in their wedding, Esther and Michael, and we realized why God had sent Michael, so that we would get to know Esther. That's how I met Esther. Esther's an amazing woman. She has a simple way of doing good and not doing harm. And it's through making bread. But it isn't just bread. In the church, the bread is a very powerful symbol. Christ took the bread and broke it. And this is the bread of life. I don't know how many doors Michael and Esther have knocked on of people that visited the church or people in the community they wanted to tell about the church that they didn't take a loaf of bread or something like that. In a very simple way, the doors opened and people come to know about these unusual Methodist people that in this world where everybody seems to want to hunker down are actually people that are trying to be together, are global in their vision, a people that believe that in what we do, we should be doing good so that the love of God can be known. I know you'll have many years of great joy with Michael because I've told you, it took us a long time to get you, Michael, into a church where you could really use your gifts and talents, and don't ever plan on leaving. Just become a Chanute.
El Shaddai, El Shaddai.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you.